and welcome to Jersey Shore Baptist Church. If you're able, let's all stand. Page number 461, we have an anchor. Turn the page number 467. The Bible stands. As we have a special.
Secure, he will my shield and hope. shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine. Will be
song that we just sang, Lord, and we thank you for breaking our chains, Lord, with your amazing grace. Lord, we just thank you for the privilege and opportunity it is to be in your house today, Lord, and we thank you for the freedoms that this country affords us, Lord. We thank you for the embassy of heaven that the church is, Lord, and our opportunity to be ambassadors for you, Lord. And I just pray that you'd help everybody in this room tonight be filled with the Holy Spirit, Lord. Help the preacher as he preaches tonight, Lord, help us, Lord, because we need it the most right now. Lord, we just pray that through our worship tonight that you would be blessed and that you would be helped, Lord. And we know you don't need help, Lord. We know that you don't need our worship. You don't need our praise, Lord. But we offer it up anyways. And we just thank you for that privilege, Lord. We thank you that you're our God, Lord, and that you are for us. And we love you. We thank you for all that you do, all that you continue to do. We pray and ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. At this time, we're going to do our song picks. We already have one that we have already picked, and it's Wonderful, Merciful Savior. And just a reminder, we are going to be skipping number 20. I'm standing on solid rock on page number 3, but I am letting you know that next week we will be able to do those again. We just can't do them every single week. Does anybody have a hymn, something that they'd like to sing here in church tonight? Anybody have a song they want to sing? Kyle. Page number 91, what a day that will be. Anybody else, something you want to sing here tonight at church? One of the hymns in the hymn book. Yes, Miss Linda. Page 38. Sun's coming up. Yes. I think that's 481. Till the storm passes by. And one more, anybody? All right, we're going to move on to our next song. I love that old Bible. If you remember, this is the one that we were learning last week. Everybody, let's sing all the verses and the chorus together tonight.
What light is that shining so brightly for me that gives me such courage?
Wondering of what book I
Bible, authorized by the King, God's wonderful book divine. And I love the old Bible, the precious old Bible, a light on my pathway to shine. And it keeps me so happy, always so happy, God's wonderful book divine.
Amen. And if you're able, let's all stand as we go to page number 307. Open my eyes that I may see.
Reminder that September 2nd, Pastor will be starting a new Bible study, the life and writings of the Apostle Paul, and that's on Wednesday nights. That's at 6:45 p.m. starting September 2nd. In this exciting study, we'll be examining the life of the Apostle Paul from the book of Acts, as well as studying verse by verse through each of the New Testament epistles written by him. Reminder to sign up for our services on our website, noon Zoom prayer meeting, Monday through Saturday at 12 o'clock through Facebook Live, or you can reach out to Pastor, send him a text if you'd like a Zoom invitation. Blood drive September 3rd, that's coming up. Please consider giving blood. You can register at redcrossblood.org. Look up the name of the church or the zip code here in Galloway, and you can set up your appointment for the blood drive September 3rd. For those that are watching online, just a reminder the three ways you can give through our website. Or two ways on our website. You can click on the giving link, you can text the number to give, text the amount, or you can mail in your check to the church address here. And then for those of us that are here, we have the offering box at the back of the church right by the map there. And we're just thankful for what God's done during these past couple of months in meeting the needs of the church. You know, I work at a bank, and I've seen a lot of churches that came into the bank to get out those government loans, and they may be helpful, but it puts a bind on some churches, and I just want to thank the Lord, praise the Lord that we didn't have to do that, and for meeting the needs of the church. Just going to praise him right now. Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you, God, for your goodness. We thank you, God, for how good you've been to us, Lord, and for meeting the needs of the church, Lord, and the faithfulness of your people in giving. God, I pray, Lord, that you would just continue, Lord, to meet the needs of the church. Lord, we trust in you and only you. And Father, we pray, Lord, that you would just have your hand over the service, Lord, as we sing the songs. Pray that we would sing them to you, Lord, and that we would magnify your name for who you are. God, we're so thankful for what you're doing. God, we love you. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
First song is not in the hymn book, but they're going to have it up on the screens. Wonderful, Merciful Savior. The sun's coming up.
What's
page number 91, what a day that will be.
There is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears within the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. And what a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by
number 481, till the storm passes by.
In the dark of the midnight have I often my face, while the storm howls above me and there's no hiding place. In the crash thunder, precious Lord, hear my cry, keep me safe till the storm passes by. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds the Lord, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast. The secrets he has kept from her so long.
just won't fade.
So many different stories we thought could not be redeemed, but it's against our darkest failures we start to see the beauty of the blood, the goodness of His grace, and mercy undeserved that could never be explained. Heaven's best takes all the scars for the mercy all of us. That's the glory of the cross, the wonder of His love. That's the beauty of the blood. What a thought, just a single drop forever wipes away our every stain, and with its chain that held us now lies at our feet, and we stand free. That's the beauty of the blood, the goodness of His grace, the mercy undeserved that could never be explained. Heaven's best takes all the scars for the worst in all of us. That's the glory of the cross, the wonder of His love. That's the beauty of the blood. Forever changed, I stand amazed by everything it does. That's the beauty of the blood, the goodness of His grace, mercy undeserved that could never be explained. Heaven's best takes all the scars for the worst in all of us. That's the glory of the cross, the wonder of His love. That's the glory of the cross, the wonder of His love.
This time we're going to do testimonies. Somebody have something that you praise the Lord for? We're just going to take a moment. Brother Isan's going to be preaching for us here tonight while he's getting ready. Does anybody have a testimony, something that happened to you this last week, this last month, something you just want to praise the Lord for here in the service here tonight?
This week I was praying for something specifically, and I was praying just for that one thing. But it turned out that the Lord gave me something better than what I was praying for. And as much as hard as it for me to admit, you pray for the Lord's will, not what you want. Just pray for His will.
Amen. Yeah, that's good. LaBelle?
I'd just like to thank the Lord that we were able to come and sing the praises to His holy name. And I just thank God for a beautiful message that every time I come in up every Sunday night, that how it blesses me during the week, and I just thank God.
Amen. Yes.
Yeah, I'd like to praise the Lord. This morning when I walked in the door, the orchestra was playing that song, Wonderful Master, whatever the name of it is, and that's one of my favorites, and I love it instrumental too. So I want to thank the orchestra for that. And then also this morning when the choir sang that song, I've been at Solid Rock when they did it, and seems like 100 people in their choir, but our choir sound just as full as 100 people being up there. So I just want to thank the choir for the hard work that they do and all the people that are involved in that. So thanks.
Amen. Praise the Lord. I got a message on Facebook Live from Miss Cindy Erickson. Tomorrow is their anniversary, and she just wants to thank God for her husband who has stuck by her through thick and thin for the last 35 years.
Amen. Praise the Lord. And we praise the Lord for our pastor and his wife. We're very thankful for them. Yes.
I basically have two of them, please. One for my thank you, God, for just taking care of my mother through all this. She's been cooped up in a retirement home, and they haven't let anybody in or out, but he's been with her, and I've taken her to a couple of doctor's appointments, and they're all positive, and she's been doing okay, so that's good. And I just want to thank God for taking care of the people who are working. We went back to work. So far, nobody's gotten sick in the casinos, as I've heard, so thank God for that, too.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Anybody else? Something you want to praise for? Sayla?
I'm thankful for my family.
Amen. And Sophia?
I'm thankful for the church.
Amen. Amen. Anybody else? Something you want to praise the Lord for here tonight? Yes.
I just want to praise the Lord for the hymn we sang this morning. There's been a couple times where I've just been thinking about something throughout the weekend, and then I come into church, and sometimes it's not like the special, or the preaching should always speak to you, but some of the hymns we sing just really stick out to me during hard times, and we were singing further along, and I think it was the last verse said, "Faithful till death, said our loving master," and just talking about there's things in life that we can't change, but there's situations that we're in, and we might not understand them, but we're not meant to. And all we need to do is stay faithful, and the Lord's going to help us out. So I'm just thankful for the way he goes through things with us. And even though they might not change, he's still there.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Yes, Ms. Tina.
I just praise God for the nice long visit that we got to have with Kyle.
Amen. Yeah, that is a blessing. And it's something we were praying for a long time here at the church. And it was just thankful to see that answer the prayer and just get to see Kyle before he goes off. So, we're very thankful for that. Yes.
I just want to praise the Lord for the message this morning. It's just crazy how God works on your heart before the message. This morning, I was reading my Bible, and I was talking to Isan, and I was just saying that this year has been, my worst year spiritually. I've just been so back and forth, and I haven't been faithful like I usually am, and it's been a rough year spiritually for me. And I just got on my knees this morning and recommitted myself. I'm like, I'm going to do this. I'm going to get my Bible every day. I'm going to pray. I'm not going to be tossed to and fro all the time with everything that comes up because I tend to do that. I tend to just take on people's emotions. Like if someone's upset about something in the news, then I get upset. Or if someone's okay about it, then I feel peace. And I'm just back and forth. And Isan this morning told me about that verse, tossed to and fro, and just being not stable and not secure. And obviously I'm not, standing on God like I should be. And I feel like God will remind me that I need him when something comes up, and then I'll cling to him for a week, and then I just slowly go back down into just not reading my Bible as much, and just in that, not a valley, but I guess just that backslidden way. But then the message this morning was just so perfect for me because I already committed myself this morning. I'm like, I'm gonna do this thing. And then I feel like God was like, here you go. This is what you need to do. Take care of your field and take care of what God's given you. And I like what Justin said too about pulling the weeds. And sometimes you think that you wake up in the morning and you just read your Bible and it's just a mundane day and you're not really doing much, but you're faithful. And it's picking that weed, even if it's one weed, it just gets you further and further along. It doesn't have to be a crazy, day where you spend so much time in the Bible and so much time in prayer and all that. It can just be one little thing that, but you're being faithful. And that just really spoke to me this morning. I really needed it. God definitely had it for me. So I'm just thankful and praise God.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Anybody else, something you want to praise the Lord for here tonight? Ellie.
I'm thankful for God.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Yes, James.
I wasn't going to say anything, but Ashley just got my brain going and message this morning too. I don't know, just fields and plants speak to me. So I went home and I weeded the garden. But I just what Ashley just said, and it just jumped in my mind. There were beans and tomatoes that were waiting to be picked that were just waiting for me. Like but I wouldn't have seen them if the weeds were there. So I don't know what that means, but I'm sure there's some kind of significance behind it.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Anybody else? Going once, going twice. All right. Lisa.
Can you hear me? Come on. There we go. All right. I also have a couple things to praise the Lord about. Some of you are on the prayer group chat. Pastor started this about 2 years ago where we just send out prayer requests. We send out updates on what's going on in the lives of our families and any requests that we have, we send updates. And one of the ones that has been very encouraging, a lot of you know, but some of you may not, is Giovanni and Kai. She used to come to our church. I think she just left a couple months ago. She moved out to Oklahoma, and her boyfriend wound up getting COVID. And you know, when you hear that, you start thinking, you know, all right, there are a lot of people that get COVID, and a lot of people come through, a lot of people don't come through. We didn't know what was going on, but she's been faithful in updating us pretty much every day since she's sent that prayer request, and we've been praying. It's been before our eyes as a church every day, and I praise the Lord for how, first of all, that he got saved a couple weeks ago. I think it's maybe 2 months now. Pastor got the opportunity to give him the gospel, and what a relief that must have been for Giovanni, knowing that he knows where he's going to go as he was looking death right in the eyes. And also for Kai, what a relief that was. And, you know, just looking at all the text messages that with all the updates, you know, a lot of times they're basically saying that, you know, you're going to need a miracle for him to recover. And he's on the ventilator. He was on the ventilator for, I don't know how many weeks he was on that for. And, you know, you get discouraged. You're praying. You think, you know, is God listening? But God has a plan. God has something that he's doing. And I just wanted to share this last text that she sent out. It says, "Hi, everyone. I spoke to the nurse today, and Giovanni is still continuing to do well with only oxygen support. The doctor came by today, and based on Giovanni's labs, they just need to give him some potassium. Otherwise, all the labs look excellent. The nurse said he's still responding by nodding his head, squeezing her hand, etc. She said she asked him if he slept well last night, and he nodded yes. The worst is definitely over, in my opinion, and Giovanni is on the road to recovery. Praise Jesus. Keep praying for the recovery." And then she gave another thing, and it says, and also the nurse said last night he's our miracle patient. And, man, that's just encouraging there. That's, you know, a lot of people have been praying a lot of hours and lifting up his name, someone that we've never met before. And that's just very encouraging that the Lord answers prayer. Mrs. Bertel just gave a testimony about praying for God's will. And, you know, sometimes we want to pray for something specifically, and although it may be good, a lot of times praying for God's will is even better, because God will have something that we didn't even know was out there. And I just praise the Lord for just Giovanni's testimony and how God's working in his life. And I praise the Lord for that. And I also praise the Lord for, along with Ashley and James, for Justin's message that really helped me this morning. And just, you get stuck in these ruts, these ruts as a Christian. You know, you move on, you live life, and you sometimes pretend like nothing's wrong, but you know, you're not taking care of what's important. And I praise the Lord for that message, and I thank God for using Justin this morning. We're going to be looking at Matthew chapter 21. There's going to be two passages of scripture that we're going to be looking at tonight. Matthew 21. And if you'll also put a marker on Matthew 27. So I'll read Matthew 21, verses 1 through 11, and then Matthew 27, verses 15 through 23. These two passages of scripture go hand in hand. The Bible goes hand in hand, but these two passages are very familiar passages and passages that are a week apart. So Matthew 21, verses 1 through 11, Bible says, "And when they drew nigh unto Jerusalem and were come to Bethphage unto the Mount of Olives, then sent Jesus two disciples, saying unto them, Go into the village over against you, and straightway ye shall find an ass tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them unto me. And if any man say aught unto you, ye shall say, The Lord hath need of them, and straightway he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled which is spoken by the prophet, saying, Tell ye the daughter of Zion, Behold, thy king cometh unto thee, meek and sitting upon an ass, and a colt, the foal of an ass. And the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded, and brought the ass and the colt, and put on them their clothes, and they set him thereon. And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way. Others cut down branches from the trees and strawed them in the way. And the multitudes that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he was come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, Who is this? And if you notice on verse 8, and a very great multitude spread their garments in the way. Other cut down branches. They literally took they went into their closets and they took their clothes and they spread them on the ground. They laid them before Jesus for him to walk into the, or to be, to ride into the temple. And just a great and exciting, a lot going on here. Now we're going to jump to Matthew 27. In verse 15 through 23, Bible says, Now at that feast, the governor was wont to release unto the people a prisoner whom they would, and they had then a notable prisoner called Barabbas. Therefore, when they were gathered together, Pilate said unto them, Whom will ye that I release unto you? Barabbas or Jesus, which is called Christ? For he knew that for envy they had delivered him. When he was set down on the judgment seat, his wife said unto him, saying, Have thou nothing to do with that just man, for I have suffered many things this day in a dream because of him. But the chief priests and elders persuaded the multitude that they should ask Barabbas. That's a key phrase there. But the chief priests and elders persuaded the multitude that they should ask Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor answered and said unto them, Whether of the twain will ye that I release unto you? They said, Barabbas. Pilate said unto them, What shall I do then with Jesus, which is called Christ? They all say unto him, Let him be crucified. And the governor said, Why? What evil hath he done? But they cried out the more, saying, Let him be crucified. Let's pray. Father, Lord, we thank you for tonight, Lord. We thank you, God, for just a great day in your house this morning, Lord, and just singing praises unto your name, Lord. And we just thank you, Father, for how you work in our lives. We thank you, God, for all the miracles that you perform on a day to day, and things that we're not aware, Lord, that you're working in our lives, Lord, that you've prepared for us. God, I just pray, Lord, that you would be with me now, Lord, as I deliver the message you've laid on my heart, Lord. I pray, God, that it would be a blessing to someone here, Lord. I pray, God, that you would hide me behind the cross, Lord. I pray, God, that it would be your word that would do the impact, Lord, in the lives of your people, Lord. And God, I thank you, Lord, for this opportunity, Lord. I do not take it for granted, Lord. And I humbly ask you, Father, to help me, to help others. God, we love you. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. These two passages of Scripture are very familiar passages if you have been saved for any length of time. Sermons are typically preached on these passages on Palm Sunday. In these passages, we see the people turn their shouts of praise into shouts of punishment. What causes a crowd to change their mind so quickly? They went from one extreme to the complete opposite in a week's time. What changed? And that's something that I always wondered as a believer. you know, literally a week after, you have these people who, a lot of them have heard about Jesus, a lot of people have heard the miracles that he's worked, but maybe do not have, thank you, Justin, maybe do not have that personal relationship with him, and they're just feeding off of what people are telling them, and they grab their clothes and they lay them before Jesus, and then a week later, I'm sure a lot of those same people are the same people shouting to for him to be crucified, and it's a bitter passage to read because you just see these two extremes. There are many possible reasons as to why this happens, but one simple reason is that their words did not match their heart. They had a conditional faith, not a committed faith. They were religious but did not have a relationship. This change of heart the people had can happen to any believer if we're not committed to the Lord. How can we have a committed faith? How can we be genuine and sincere? This evening I'd like to share with you three steps to a committed faith. So this is, you know, a lot of times when we read the Bible, we read about the children of Israel and all the mistakes that they make, all the murmurings, and, you know, why don't they learn? There's so many, thousands and thousands of people that die as a result of people murmuring and people talking bad about the man of God. And we, you know, I sit back and say, man, why don't they just learn? Why don't they just do what God's telling them to do? And right away, the Holy Spirit tells me that's what I've been trying to get you to do, is you read the Word of God, you read the Bible, yet you still do the same foolish things, you still lack faith, and if we're not careful, our faith may not be committed. Having a committed faith requires a relationship. And they did not show sign of a relationship. If you go to Matthew 21 and verse 10, they did not show a sign of a relationship. Their words did not match their hearts. Matthew 21 verse 10 says, "And when he was come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, Who is this?" So you have these people here. You have the same people that are throwing out their clothes and that are shouting Hosanna. They're just going with what the crowd's doing. It's a good thing that they're doing. They're praising Jesus. They're glorifying him, but they didn't have that personal relationship. And I want to encourage anyone here who does not have a personal relationship with Christ, man, doing church or being around Christians must be very exhausting if you're not saved, if you don't have that personal relationship, and you have to get that settled. And, you know, heaven's a real place, but hell is a real place as well. And there's more scriptures, passages of scriptures that are preached on hell that are in the Bible about hell than there is of heaven. And I just want to encourage you, if you do not know the Lord, man, there's multitudes of resources here. We have multitude of people that can share their faith with you. But you see here that their faith, that they don't have that personal relationship with Christ. If you want to be committed to Christ, a daily relationship with him is essential. Go to James chapter 4. A lot of times when I'm in spiritual ruts, when I just feel like, you know, my prayers are bouncing off the walls, I'm not in that right relationship with God, I always come to this passage here, James chapter 4. Verse 8, the Bible says, "Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded." And man, isn't that something that we all struggle with, being double-minded? You know, one day we have our Sunday mind frame, and then we have our Monday through Saturday mind frame. We have a double mind, and if we want to be committed to Christ, it's going to take having a personal relationship with him, spending enough time with him. It is difficult to turn away from God when you're constantly in awe of his overwhelming love. If you realize what Christ has done for you, man, just read the end of each of the Gospels and realize what he did for you, the pain that he endured, knowing that he was going to die, knowing the horrible death that he was going to take, that it was going to take, and he still did it. God himself came and died for you. And if you really grasp and get a hold of that, we can never fully understand it, but if you grab just a little bit of that, that will do enough in your heart that will cause you to stay committed to him. How much time do you devote to your relationship with the Lord? In 1989, Family Life Today article said that married couples spend an average of 27 and a half minutes per week talking to each other. According to Ray Bridwistle, speech communication expert, however, they spend 46 hours per week watching TV. And I'm sure that's changed since 1989. We have so much more at our fingertips now that has just taken our attention away from our families, from our loved ones, from the things that are important, from really spending time with God. And, you know, when you wake up, what's your first move? What's your first move when you wake up? Do you think about God? Do you think about what you're going to do that day? What is it? And that's where your heart is. And you're going to have to develop an appetite for the Word of God if you're in a spiritual rut. It takes some time, but God's faithful. And the Bible says, draw nigh to God and he will draw nigh to you. Number two, having a committed faith is realizing it must be Christ-centered. Having a committed faith is realizing it must be Christ-centered. Go to Matthew 6, verse 33. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. One of the things I love about the Bible is how simple and clear the Bible is. Yes, there's some passages, some prophetic passages that we may not be sure about, and some of them the Lord may reveal to us at a later time as our relationship grows with him. But some of the key foundational passages that shape the way we're supposed to live our lives are very, very clear. They're very simple. There's no way of misinterpreting it. It says there, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. How many times do we try to fit God into our schedule and our plans? We should put God first at work. You know, when you go to work, it's when you walk in through the door, a lot of times you flip on the switch, okay, I'm at work. I have my daily tasks that I have to do, the projects that I'm working on. But how about putting God first? How about trying that? And yes, you have responsibilities. Yes, you have things that you have to get accomplished. But there's people that God has there for you to be a witness to. There's people there that are hurting. There's people there that are watching you. I think it was Wade that said it, or he didn't say it, he said that someone else said it on Wednesday, that for some people, you're the only, Christians are the only Bible that they'll ever read. And man, that's so true, and we have to be careful how we live our lives. We have to be careful of putting God first, because there's people watching. We have children that watch us. We have teenagers. We have adults, people that get saved later in life. They may look at someone that's younger as an example, and we have to be mindful of that and putting God first. About putting God first when you go out with your friends, you know, that's something that you don't see nowadays. I appreciate our singles class. They went out to spend some time with Kyle this past week, and we weren't able to make it, but I appreciate young people that love the Lord being able to go together somewhere and be a good testimony for the Lord. And that's something that you don't see out there. That's something that is rare, that sticks out like a sore thumb, but all glory goes to God. And I appreciate that. How about when you're at home with your family? You know, keep it Christ-centered. A lot of times we wake up and we think, you know, it's all about us. We don't say it, but we live that way. And we have to be careful. What did John say in, I believe it's John 3:30, he must increase, but we must decrease. Or I must decrease, paraphrasing. We have so many opportunities during the day of putting him first. When I got saved early on in life, Pastor Erickson gave me an acronym that I'll never forget, and it's very simple, and many of you must know it or may know it, and that's the acronym ENJOY: Jesus, others, you. And that's something that he always drilled into us as teenagers in when we serve. First, we serve. Everything that we do for the Lord. We keep him in mind. We put him first in those areas of life. And then come other people, and then you take care of yourself. And God's always going to take care of us. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. In our text, the people were praising Jesus because of his miracles, because they saw him as a political savior. He came in as a prince of peace. We go to Zechariah, and that's a couple books over. Zechariah chapter 9, second to last book of the New Testament, or of the Old Testament. Zechariah 9, verses 9 through 10. The Bible says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, thy king cometh unto thee. He is just and having salvation, lowly, and riding upon an ass and upon a colt, the foal of an ass. And I will cut off the chariots from Ephraim and the horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall speak peace unto the heathen, and his dominion shall be from sea even to sea, and from the river even to the ends of the earth." And we know that when Jesus first arrived, that he arrived to bring forth salvation. We see that in that scripture. He came on a donkey. The second time he arrives, he's coming to bring about his kingdom. He's going to come on a horse. And the people had this expectation. They were going to wipe away the religious system, that Jesus was here to wipe away the religious system. He was going to come here to wipe away the Roman Empire. And they jumped the gun. They didn't realize that he came first to die for our sins. Jesus first came to meet our spiritual need, not our earthly expectation. Go to John chapter 10, verse 10. John 10, verse 10. The Bible says, "The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly." And praise the Lord that he came that first time to die for our sins, to pay the penalty for our sin debt, so that we could have eternal life. Do we wake up every day wondering what our day has in store for us? Instead, we should wake up asking God how he will be using us that day. And man, that's easier said than done. You know, we have things that are before us, responsibilities. We have bills to pay. We have people that we have to please. But sometimes we have to stop and reset and remember that God stays at the center, that Christ is the center. We put too much pressure on ourselves when we are in charge of our own lives and are at the center of everything. You know, when you try to juggle too many things, it can be very dangerous for you. It can be very dangerous for those around you, your family, your friends. And, you know, you may get away with it for some time, but you may also be neglecting some of the important things in life. You may be neglecting time spent with your family, time being used, being a witness to someone else. Don't put too much pressure on yourself. Another one of my favorite verses, "Casting all your cares upon him, for he careth for you." And man, does God care about us? He died for us. You know, we entrust him with our eternal security. We entrust him with taking us to heaven when we die. But the little things, man, it's hard for us to let go. It's hard for us to give someone else our burdens. We feel like there are responsibility, there are way of finding maybe success of alleviating them and getting rid of them, but putting too much pressure on yourselves, give it to God. Thirdly, having a committed faith will mean remaining steadfast. That Palm Sunday, it was popular to shout out, "Hosanna in the highest," but at the trial, speaking up for Jesus was risky and not popular at the time. You know, it wasn't recorded in any of the four Gospels that someone stuck up for Jesus. That was something that everyone would have turned to that person and gave them a really hard time. Remember, it was only John that was there at the crucifixion. The other 12 disciples, the other 11, were nowhere to be found. And we have to remain steadfast. That's something that, as a Christian, if you want to have a committed faith, if you want to stick into it for the long run, you have to remain steadfast. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 58 says, "Therefore, my beloved brethren," and Paul writes this in closing in 1 Corinthians, "Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord." And man, something about sticking it out, something about the Christian life is not a sprint. And so many times we treat it as a sprint. We treat it as get so much done as quick as I can because I don't know what's going to happen. Yes, we don't know what's going to happen, but we know that being faithful, being steadfast, being there for those that matter is more important than getting these accolades here on earth. And storing our treasures up in heaven is something that we will need steadfastness for. The crowd's expectations was for everything to go according to plan, but the reality of Christ's trial troubled their faith. Ephesians chapter 4, if you would turn there, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 14, we talked about this during testimony time. Ephesians 4, verse 14. "That we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive." And man, you can apply this till this time that we're living in right now. There's just watching the news and watching all of the different opinions out there of what's going on, people that we've never heard of before, and just putting all of our energy, all of our attention into words of people that we don't know, words of people that may not be even saved, don't have the wisdom of God. And it's something that can be very dangerous. As Christians, we need to depend on the Word of God. We need to depend on Him who knows all things and not on those who say they do. "That we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro." And if you observe little kids and you look at them, they're easily convinced. If I want one of my kids to do something, or I want them to pick something other than the other thing, I know how to phrase what I want them to do before saying it so that they can do what I want them to do. I can't think of an example now, but you know what I'm saying. And the Bible does not want us to be that way. You know, there's people out there that manipulate their words, that will coat their words so that you can think something else. But no, how about screening things through the Word of God, screening things through prayer, asking God, "Hey God, is this what you want my family to do? Is this what you want me to do?" Often when we ask for a person's signature, we will call it their John Hancock. This is because of the 56 signatures on the Declaration of Independence. One stood out above the rest. That signature belongs to John Hancock. He was the first to sign the Declaration, and he signed it in large and legible script so that the king
of England could read his name without using glasses. Mr. Hancock wanted it to be very clear where his allegiance lay. His commitment to his country was so clear that when King George III offered amnesty to all who would cease fighting, John Hancock was among the select few who were left off the offer. So John Hancock was committed to the forming of our nation. He knew that it was something that was needful, and he wasn't ashamed of it. As Christians, we need to sign over our lives. We need to commit our lives over to God. And whatever it is that God has for us, that's what God has for us. And we're no one to question him. We're no one to ask why or to compare with someone else. For many of us, this pandemic has been an unforgettable trial in our lives. And, you know, you can get overwhelmed thinking about all of the people that, all of the lives that were lost, people losing businesses, people losing their retirement, people losing different things. Sermon after sermon has been preached and listened to. Warning signs have been displayed and are still being displayed. We cannot bury our heads in the sand pretending everything is fine. You know, we spend so much time as Christians coming to church, learning from the Bible, learning from the preacher, and those messages have been preached, warning us about a time like this, a trial. And, you know, God has us here for a specific reason. How will God use you in this time period? When you look back to these past couple of months, and I hope it's just a couple of months, what will you say to your grandchildren? What will you say to your children? Will you have stories of how God worked in your life? Will you have stories of how you were used of God? Don't let this opportunity of committing to the Lord go to waste. Use it for his glory. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you, God, for tonight. Lord, we thank you, God, for your faithfulness. God, we thank you, Lord, that you're in charge, Lord. And God, so many times, Lord, we put ourselves in charge and we get ourselves in trouble. And God, I pray, Lord, that we would recommit our lives to you, Lord. I pray, God, that you would use us for your honor and for your glory. God, I pray, Lord, that we would be faithful to you in our Bible reading, in our prayer. God, I pray, Lord, that you would have your hand over each life that is here, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, for the faithfulness of your people. We thank you, God, for how you work. God, we pray, Lord, that you would just bless now. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.